dinner party of this guy and I all his stories.
This guy is an important guy too.
He's important. He's more important than I am. He's taller than I am.
Come down and help us celebrate the 90th birthday of Earl Albers. Where is Earl? Oh, okay. Well, there'll be a short delay while we get some water. Well, here's what we have planned, and we won't take too long to get you to the cake and coffee if you don't already have coffee. I'll take just a couple minutes to introduce the family members that are here sitting among you. I'm going to summarize Earl Albers' life in 300 words or less. And if I do, that will be the first time that Albers has ever told a story in 300 words. I see a lot of agreement there. Earl's four grandsons, each has something they would like to say, so we'll bring them up. We'll sing happy birthday, cut the cake, and while we're having cake and coffee and conversation, I'll show a slideshow with some very interesting pictures of Earl's life. His daughter, Yana. Yana, would you stand? Yana is a pharmacist. She's been close to her career in the public health service. My wife, Becky. Becky is also a journalist, a reporter and editor, a writer and editor. Yana's husband, Merrill.
What's his name?
I was going to introduce you to Will, what's his name, but I said your name. So. I had a family reunion years ago. My mother got up with her family, and when it came time to introduce everybody, when she got to Merrill, she couldn't remember his name. So she introduced him as, oh, what's his name? My sons, my oldest son, Ross. Ross is a lawyer. He's works for the Baltimore State's Attorney's Office. And on the camera here, our youngest son, Reed. Reed is in the family business. He's a journalist, too. He's a reporter for Fairfax Times, covers high school sports. And he also covers the Washington Capitals hockey team for the Express newspaper. And then Jan and Merrill's oldest son, Matthew. I've lost track of where everybody is. There's Matthew. Matthew's a graduate. Not much applause for Matthew. Well, wait till you hear about Matthew, then they'll probably be some. He's a graduate of the University of Maryland. He's currently at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute in Troy, New York, where he's working on his doctorate in nuclear physics. Which is the other family business, journalism, and then a lot of us are in nuclear physics. And their youngest son, Mark, who's a freshman this year at the University of Maryland. I think you're majoring in information systems and computer sciences, yeah. Is that right? Now, Earl Albers' life in 300 words or less. November 24th, 1920, on a farm in southeastern Nebraska. His mother later told him that he ruined her Thanksgiving, born the day before Thanksgiving. He graduated from Lewiston, Nebraska High School, and I'm proud to say that he was in the top 10 in a class of 8. So you know where Matthew gets his intelligence. He attended the University of Nebraska in Lincoln for 1 year, but then he moved to Los Angeles for what he told me was just too high-paying a job to turn down. I think it was $3 an hour in an aircraft plant. And he lived in Los Angeles for 2 years. And if he hasn't told you these stories already, you've got to get him to tell you about drinking with the actor John Barrymore, which he says he did. being paid $50 by the actor Cesar Romero to find him a parking space near Brownman's Chinese Theater, and meeting Betty Davis in the supermarket checkout line. Now, how many have heard those stories? Oh, I'm going to find him at supper now. When his father became too ill to farm, he had multiple sclerosis, or was it Lou Gehrig's? Multiple sclerosis. Earl moved back to Nebraska to be close to his mother and his brothers. He tried four different times to join the Army Air Forces and was classified 4F every time for a heart murmur. So you know what happened next. The Army drafted him. He was sent to Berlin and arrived there in May 1946, about 9 months or so after the war ended. General Lucius Clay, who was the commander of the American forces, caught him teaching baseball to German children. And instead of court-martialing him for fraternizing with Germans, which wasn't allowed at the time, he ordered him to form youth clubs. Pretty quickly, he was running three clubs for German youth and managing six others in Berlin that served thousands of kids. And this GYA program, German Youth Activities, eventually had 300 clubhouses in the American zone in Germany. He returned to Nebraska. He was surprised to find that Ruth Tegmeyer was not married yet, and he promptly asked her to marry him. He promised her that as a career military man, he would show her the world. And in 56 years of marriage, they moved 28 times. honest to God. He stayed in the Army for 30 years, or a little over 30 years. During that time, he had two tours in South Korea, which the family couldn't go with him on. He also had a tour in Vietnam while the war was on. I think you were actually there during the Tet Offensive, weren't you? And he retired in 1974 with the rank of Sergeant Major, which is the highest enlisted rank. He stayed busy after retirement, as I think all of you know, and among things he did, he was a security guard at a naval ammunition depot. He worked in a funeral home. He started what became, I think, the largest AARP chapter in Florida. He started that in Kissimmee, Florida. And for years, he taught 55 Alive driving classes until the day that most of his students were arrested making illegal turns after leaving class. 298, 299, 300. I did it.
As a child, when I would do homework, especially math problems, I'd give it to my parents and they would check it and they mark which ones that I got wrong and tell me to go back and fix it. And one day, my parents were out of town and grandpa and my grandmother were watching us, my brother and I had some math homework, probably about 50 problems. And so I went upstairs to my room and did my math homework and brought it down to Grandpa, and I said, Grandpa, I'm ready for you to check it. And he said, okay. And I went down to the basement or with my brother and we hung out, and about a half an hour later my grandfather said, I've got your homework checked, come in and let's talk. And so I went into the dining room table and I sat down with him, and he said, Ross, you got 7 problems wrong. And I go, okay. And he goes, I'm not going to tell you which 7 you got wrong. You're going to have to go back and look at all 50 and do them over.
Oh, wow.
And I thought, you got to be kidding me. This guy was a teacher at one point in his life. So, sure enough, I went back and I looked at all 50, and I came into the dining room and I said, Grandpa, all 50 of them are right. You're wrong on 7 of them. And eventually, after battling it out, I got him to show me which ones were wrong. But sure enough, that's my favorite story about Grandpa. At the time, he wouldn't tell me which problems I got wrong on my math.
My two favorite stories are, the first one is when we went to Busch Gardens, and at the age of, in his 70s, he got on the Kumbah roller coaster with us 4 grandsons. And I thought that was pretty amazing that somebody of his age would be willing to get on a roller coaster that did loops in the air. He wasn't afraid to have some fun. The other time was when we went to, what was it, must have been Gator World. And I remember going into Gator World with him. I don't think Ross and Reed were with me at the time, but we were walking around this gator pen, and Grandpa had his cane, and I said, boy, those gators are pretty close to the fence line, and so he decided to stick his cane right through the middle of the cracks of those fence, and he gave each of the gators a little pop on the nose just to make sure that they were alive. So those two stories seem to illustrate to me that Grandpa, despite being a very serious man at times, he knew how to have fun, and he was a good grandpa.
That's good.
Something about me is I'm a picky eater. But Grandpa, he's not really one for picky eaters, and he didn't really appreciate that in me. So one time when we went down there, we bought a bunch of ice cream, a couple of ice cream cartons, and he wanted to have a taste test. And he blindfolded Matthew and Mark and Ross, and I refused to put the blindfold on because I didn't know what I was going to be eating. And we got into a big argument about, I need to eat this ice cream, you need to be a part of this taste test. And I looked at Grandpa in the eyes and I told him, I don't eat anything that I can't see. And he just gave me the funniest look. And after that, I don't think Grandpa ever really challenged me on eating, being a picky eater anymore. It was always fun, those trips in Florida. There was the time that Grandpa left Ross and I in Disney World for 2.5 hours alone because Matthew did not want to hear my brother and I argue anymore. I remember sitting in the back of his old Lincoln Town car soaking wet because he let us sit in the front row to see Shamu at SeaWorld. And I'm sure that didn't do very much for the value of his car. It's stinking like sea salt and everything. But those were some of the most fun summers I ever had. And I was always thankful to spend them with my grandpa and grandma, so.
My cousin told you a story, Grandpa the teacher, Grandpa the achiever, and how great a grandfather is. I'm gonna tell you about Grandpa the trickster. Well, my family and I, my brother, my mom, my dad, and I, Grandpa and Grandpa, we're going to South Dakota. And as we're traveling on South Dakota, there's not much to look at. And so I'm just playing my video games, not paying attention to Grandpa. Grandpa had other plans for that. I'm playing a video game, and he points out something. Some hideous creatures, that's a wombat. They live around these parts, in the caves, behind the hills, and behind the rocks and the trees. And then as a young child, I believe everything my grandfather says, because I don't know any better. And so I start freaking out, and it turns from a boring trip, is everyone is having fun at me, because of what Grandpa did. But it made me realize that you have to find the humor in life, and that no matter what, who gets made fun of, it's fun for everyone. And I had fun. I had my own fun. I got to be paranoid for a week or two. But, I mean, I learned not to trust Grandpa. I love you, Grandpa.
I wasn't planning on doing this, but since my son mentioned Grandpa the trickster, I figured I would tell a few stories I'm sure he hasn't told about himself. And as long as we're doing a little roast dad, I thought you wouldn't mind. One of the first ones I remember was when I was 11 years old. My brother and I were living with him in Fort Bragg, North Carolina. And he came home from work and he says, Yana, get in the bedroom, I'm going to spank you. And I'm like, I didn't do anything, Dad. Get in the bedroom, don't argue, I'm going to spank you. And my brother's like, Dad, she didn't do anything. Wes, be quiet, I'm going to spank Yana. He says, Yana, get in that bedroom. And I'm like, gee, you better not argue. You're really going to get into trouble. So I go into the bedroom. He closes the door. He's taking his belt off. And he says to me, when I hit the bed, the pillow with the belt, you cry. He says, I've always wanted to do this. Whap! Ah! Whap! Ah! That's my father. The other, my father, the trickster, has to do with a trip to Berlin one time. And I was probably a little bit younger, maybe 10. And my mother at the time had been working and had a security clearance. And we traveled by train through East Berlin, through East Germany into Berlin. And while we were there, he visited with some of his old friends from Berlin. And he wanted to make sure Wes and I would behave ourselves. So he told us, with the house we're going to, is right on the wall, and they have access to the other side. And if you don't behave yourself, they know your mother works for a security agency, and they will take and capture us all and take us over to East Germany. You never saw two more well-behaved children. And my mother never understood why, because we didn't tell her anything. He says, don't say anything to your mother. And it was not until about 3 years ago that my brother finally figured out, after I told him, that my dad had just made up that story.
Any place we went, they could order anything they wanted off the menu. I didn't care what it was. Until one day we stopped at a place out in the forest, and you could tell when we walked in, there were four glasses on the table that they served course meals. And I didn't think anything about it until Wesley ordered duck under glass in the middle of the day, and it wasn't inexpensive. But he got his duck under glass, and of course he didn't eat it all. So I told him that day, henceforth, whenever you order anything, you got to eat it or you're going to pay for it. When we go home, I'll take the money out of your piggy bank. And they were very much into savings. I never had to order many meals that weren't just hamburger after that.
Happy birthday.